March is National Cerebral Palsy Awareness Month. Cerebral palsy describes a group of permanent disorders which affect a person's posture, balance, and ability to move, communicate, eat, sleep, and learn. The cause of this is attributed to non-progressive disturbances that occurred in the developing fetal or infant brain.
Today we are joined by physiotherapist Andrea Cameron and Stacey Ann Sutherland, mother of a child with CP, to discuss the challenges that cerebral palsy children and parents face in living in Jamaica. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to Sunrise.
Hi, thank
Andrea.
You.
How are you?
I'm fine.
And I know we have Stacey on screen as well. Hi, Stacey. And hi, King. You know, this is, I know I just said what it is, but can you break it down for us, like for anybody who doesn't know, what is cerebral palsy?
Okay. Cerebral palsy is just it's like an umbrella term. Mm. It's a name given to when kids are born and they're unable to move, they have difficulty, sort of one of the first things you see is, oh, the kid's not holding up their head, or they have stiffness on one side of the body, or their legs are becoming stiff. They're not following their developmental milestones. So cerebral palsy is the name given to describe what we are seeing, but it does not indicate what the cause is. So you can get a diagnosis of cerebral palsy, and it's the most common description of all these terms, but it's your child with cerebral palsy and another child with cerebral palsy will have a totally different presentation.
Well, what are some of those daily challenges for children?
Well, think about it. About a third of these children are unable to walk.
Oh, so motor skills are affected.
Motor skills are significantly affected for some. They have difficulty eating. They have difficulty sleeping. As they get older, a lot of them have problems with their hip. Because you're not standing, your hip joint doesn't develop, and therefore you're more prone to like subluxation, which is like a partial dislocation of the hip, which becomes extremely painful. These kids have seizure disorders, epilepsy. They have pain.
Yes.
They have problems with continence.
Right.
Think about that. Think about all the things I'm saying to you.
Yes.
And think about the degree of care
that
their parents to put forward.
I had a friend who experienced cerebral palsy, and he explained that was the diagnosis, and it caused the twisting of the face. His speech was affected. But over time, he told me, the doctor said, it will be normalized. It will restore for some.
That's not true.
So that's what I'm about to ask.
That is not true.
Okay.
Cerebral palsy indicates a lifetime of permanent physical disability. The severity can vary. I can have a physical disability and I can walk. Or I can have a physical disability and I have to be confined to a wheelchair. I have to have every single one of my needs met for me. So it's a broad spectrum of disability.
Right.
And we like to pretty up things. There's nothing nice about cerebral palsy.
It's probably a reassurance.
I want to talk to Stacey, who is actually, really living a real life experience of being a parent to a child who has cerebral palsy. And I just kind of want to talk to you a little bit about what your experience has been like. You're one of the most optimistic women I know, and you are such a wonderful mother. And I just kind of want you to give us an eye into what both of your lives are like.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, King wasn't really diagnosed with cerebral palsy until last year, due to me reaching out to some doctors overseas. You know, since he was 9 months, we realized that he wasn't, you know, developing, he wasn't sitting up on his own. So after going to his pediatrician, she recommended that I go and see Andrea. And she has been doing physical therapy with King since King was 9 months. So think of it as, you know, your kid will start to develop to the point that they become independent. Mm-hmm. With King, he has always been dependent on us. So it's like having a newborn for an extended period of time. We still have to feed him. We still have to, you know, he's still wearing diapers. He will walk, because in his head, he can still walk. So if you hold his hands, he will walk, but he can't walk on his own. He can't sit up unsupported. So, I mean, even trying to get health insurance for him was a problem, because a lot of the health insurance agencies viewed this as a pre-existing condition and they didn't want to give me health insurance for him. Mm. The cost for therapy in Jamaica is not cheap. He requires different levels of therapy, which I found out after coming here. You know, you have your physical therapy, your speech therapy, and your occupational therapy. And some of these aren't available in Jamaica at the magnitude that a child like him requires. Dr. Cameron can confirm for me, but I believe there are about 3 or 4 speech therapists throughout the whole island. Mm-hmm. So even before coming here, I wanted to get King into speech therapy, but he was put on our wait list. And months were passing by, and I still wasn't able to get a session with him. Mm-hmm. With us coming to the States now, because, you know, God works in mysterious ways. I was watching TV, and I saw a commercial for Shriners Children's Hospital, mm-hmm. sent them an email, followed all the necessary steps, and they approved to see King's case. We came to the U.S. in February, and he has been seeing occupational therapists, physical therapists, speech therapists, if not once, twice a week. And guys, it has been life-changing for both of us. Like, since I've been here with King, King has said mama more times in the past month than he's had in the past 5 years. You know? But that alone makes me know that the treatment that he's getting works. The reality is that it's just not available in Jamaica. And on a wider scale, the doctors just don't know how to handle kids with special needs. They don't know how to proper diagnose them. You know, there were times in the first 2 years after we found out that something was off with King that I had to be going to Bustamante probably 2-3 times a week, every other week. You know, and I felt like I just was getting the go around. You know, it's going to this clinic, going to that clinic. And they gave him the diagnosis of global developmental delay, which is a broad, broad, broad diagnosis. But there was no, you know, no guidelines like, okay, this is the kind of care that he needs. Here at Shriners, it's like the first day we got here and we went to see them, it was like doctors back to back to back to back. Just coming in and taking measurements, doing this, you know, integrating with him to see what his specific needs are. And then they just gave me a schedule, you know, and I mean, God is so good with how he's working within King. And yeah, I mean, back home, I just honestly felt like the medical system failed us, because I tried to get as much answers as I could, you know, with all the tests. And I mean, I'm honestly speaking as someone who can somewhat afford to see doctors outside of public health care. But for most parents who I have met along my journey, who live in rural Jamaica, mm-hmm. don't have that same, you know, think about public transport. Mm-hmm. Is it too accessible? Yeah. You have parents who literally don't have schools that they can send their kids to, because a lot of these schools aren't integrated for the for kids with special needs. So I mean, the government needs to do a whole lot better.
You know, I'm saying, and as I listen to you and I hear that unmistakable compassion and love and dedication and determination for your child, I mean, I'm moved by it and I'm encouraged by it. You call him King. That name, you know, you deliberately, I'm sure you're very deliberate in that. You call him King. And I'm just hoping, as you have hoped, that you will see and experience more progress. Because he said for the very first time in years, you heard him say, Mama.
I can just imagine. That must have been for you. You know, we really do need to do better. Mm. I know we don't have the resources. I know that, you know, there's a lot of work that has to be done, but yes, it's so important for us to continue to raise awareness about this. And I would love you to share with us why.
Well, I think since COVID, particularly since COVID,
yes,
there's been a malaise in terms of programs, projects, what's happening for adults and children with disabilities. Because yes, remember, mm-hmm, these little kids grow up to be adults,
right,
who can't access the workforce.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
Their houses are not modified, mm-hmm, to have hoists,
yeah,
and things to lift them. So I work at a school called, mm-hmm, the Step Center. Mm-hmm. King goes to that school. And we take kids up until like they're 18 years old. And then what happens? Mm. They go home.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So
what we need is the same amount of attention that is spent, and you know the big thing is STEM. Mm-hmm. But we need a collaborative effort. We need a center where children who have cerebral palsy and other developmental disabilities can go and be assessed the same, mm-hmm, way King has been assessed, mm-hmm, at Trinos. Mm-hmm. And then we could collaborate, and each kid is seen as a case, and all their needs, we're going to try to address them. Mm-hmm. The cost of therapy is phenomenally expensive, but there is something called community-based rehab,
mm-hmm,
and Jamaica was very active, where they train people to go into the community, mm-hmm, and work with the kids in their homes. Mm-hmm. But that program now has suffered from a lack of funding and a lack of drive.
Mm-hmm. Whoa, mm-hmm, whoa. Mm-hmm. I'm listening to you, I'm wondering, what's the cause of cerebral palsy?
We don't know.
Is it non-communicable?
It's a non-communicable disease.
Yes.
Most of it, they believe, just happens as the kid is developing in utero.
Oh.
So between 70 and 80% of the cases have no cause per se, as just when their central nervous system is being laid down, something goes wrong.
Mm-hmm. Right, right, right.
How people prevent this is very difficult,
mm-hmm,
because it's happening in utero.
Yeah, and you don't know.
So
yeah,
a lot of moms, as far as they are concerned, they've had an uneventful, normal pregnancy.
Right. Yeah, wow, interesting, wow. Crazy. This is very interesting, and I think, you know, for so many people, this is connecting on so many different levels. And, you know, even Stacey, thank you so much for being on with us this morning and being willing to share your story.
Yes.
And I do hope that we will see a change in the years to come where we are doing better, as you said.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for joining us
today.
And thank you for all of the work that you are doing, the incredible work that you're doing.
Thank you.
The Step Center is an incredible place as well, which, you know, I think needs all the love and highlight that it can possibly get as well. So we appreciate you. That was physiotherapist Andrea Cameron and, of course, Stacey Ann Sutherland, our very own. After the break, the Easter celebration continues with bun and cheese ice cream.
Bun.
You've never seen a sunrise quite like this.
Bun and cheese.
I don't know how I feel about that.
Does it take a trophy to make you?